Hi everyone. I thought I'd do something a little bit different this week and do a book review. I actually have quite an extensive library of machining and metalworking books, and this is one that I thought you would really get a kick out of. It's from Popular Mechanics. It's all articles that were written for the magazine and then put into book form, and this is 40 Power Tools You Can Make. I got this for the princely sum of $8 from a used bookstore years ago, and it's just got a ton of different homebrew tools. I guess, you know, they didn't have Harbor Freight and Lowe's back then, so people would just make what they could. The very first one's a homemade bandsaw from pipe fittings and auto parts, so you can see some wheel bearings there. I think it says in the article to use them from a Model T. Got another bandsaw made out of plywood. This one actually makes me think a lot. I kind of like this. It's a drill press made out of pipe fittings, and it seems kind of doable. This is probably my favorite in the whole book. I might do it. I'm not really sure. Let me know down in the comments if you want to see me try. I could certainly make it just like it is in the article, or I could potentially modify the design and make it a little bit less death trappy. I don't know. There's a couple of other projects that I wouldn't mind doing too, and I've got a bunch of little tabs here. So some of them are really humorous, and some of them are just ones that I wanted to show off because they're so scary. This one would be really cool. It's a big belt sander, like a double belt sander, but I don't think it would fit anywhere in my shop. I have a one-car garage, so that's not going to do it for me, but still, a pretty cool little thing. There are also some handy tips in here. This one's maybe not so handy, but certainly scary. It says if you need a little bit of extra capacity in your four-jaw chuck, this is the workpiece there. You can just take out a couple of jaws and put some stud screws in its place and clamp it down that way and get a little extra extra length out of your parts. No thanks from me. I don't think I'll do that. There's a bunch of really neat things in here. This one's kind of interesting. I tagged that. Ball keeps studs from loosening. The gist of it is if you're having trouble with a screw backing out because of vibration, I said center drill the end, split the end, and then drop a ball bearing in the hole before you put the screw in. That way, when you tighten it up, it spreads out the split end of the screw and locks it in place. I guess in the days pre-Loctite, this is one way of handling that problem. Let's see what I got here. The next one that I've got tabbed. This one I tagged in orange because it's frightening to me. Cast iron pulleys removed by breaking. The gist of this one is that if you had to remove a pulley from a line shaft, meaning shafts running overhead and powering every machine in the shop, it was a lot easier and cheaper to just have a couple of guys break them off. And it says actually one of them holds an anvil against the top of the hub while the other uses a sledgehammer on the underside. In this way, there is no danger of springing or otherwise damaging the shaft. I'm doubtful of that. Here's a neat one. An aid in laying out metalwork, and it talks about a homebrew dykem recipe, basically. I'm sure everything is very difficult to come by now and almost certainly carcinogenic, but still, very cool to see. Now, this one is really cool, and I want to try this out. Two shafts gripped in line while transferring holes. Basically, they show it as two shafts, one above the other, in a V-block, and they've got these pins here on either side of the clamp. So the pins are acting as a separate V-block for the upper shaft, and I'm thinking, anyway, that the way it would work is that they would tighten down against the one on the bottom as well. So you would be pinching the two shafts together with these four pins. I'm going to test that out one of these days and see if that actually works. The idea, of course, is that if you needed to transfer a hole from one or you needed to drill them both at the same time to make sure that they were aligned, of course, you can do that on a milling machine as well. But it's still a neat idea. I'm going to try that out. This one I had tagged because it's pretty interesting. A metal turning lathe for model makers. It looks like a small lathe, maybe in the 8x20 range, something like that. All made out of basically scrap metal and blocks. Angle iron there for the frame. I'm sure it wouldn't be terribly solid, but if you couldn't find a lathe, you know, it's something to look at. It might be fun for someone to make their own machine. Here's one that I definitely tagged in orange. Bluing and blackening brassware. The gist of it is a homemade solution for blackening brass or giving brass a patina. And the recipe calls for HIPO, which is a development chemical for silver photographic negatives, and lead acetate. So you dissolve those in water, and if you need to, just add a little more lead acetate if you're not getting enough activity. So I'm sure that's totally super healthy and OSHA approved. This is a fun one. Welder's drill and grinder from an old auto starter. So that right there, that's how people broke their wrists in the 40s. I have this one tagged as a pretty neat little tip. I'm not sure when I would ever use it, but who knows, it may come up. It's notches cut in the eye of a lathe dog to adapt it for square stock. So I don't know if you can see it on camera. They basically just filed a couple of notches in that teardrop shaped hole that a lathe dog would usually have so that you could actually fit a decent sized piece of square stock in there. It wouldn't matter if those were concentric or anything because the stock would be located by the center drilled hole in the end. You'd be turning this between centers. So I think that's pretty neat. And then on the opposite page of that is another one that I think would be a pretty cool project. Homemade filing machine. It's a small die filer. Looks relatively simple and could be pretty fun to make. I actually have a casting kit from one of the companies that sells those things for a die filer. I've had it for years. It's been in storage just because I haven't had time to get to it. But that might be something that I dig up and maybe try making. It's a pretty cool little deal. And if you don't know what a die filer is, it's basically a table. The file reciprocates up and down, and you can use it for squaring off corners, adding draft, doing all sorts of stuff. You can angle the table, as you can see right there. So they're pretty neat little machines, and I think that would be a neat little addition to my shop. I don't have a ton of space, like I mentioned, so that die filer and that drill press at the beginning of the video, those wouldn't take up a whole lot of space in my shop, so they might actually be something I'd want to do. The last thing I had tagged is a 1940s reference to the paper trick. The paper trick is when you use paper to find the end of an end mill or cutter and use that to set it without touching off on the part, which would of course scratch your part. I've actually got a video planned pretty soon where I test out the paper trick to see how accurate it is, and I'm going to be testing different types of paper to see if it has an effect on the accuracy at all. Let me know what you think about the whole book review thing down in the comments. Like I said, I've got a pretty extensive library of metalworking and machining books, and if you like the format, then I'll be more than happy to show off some of my other favorite books. If you think I've earned it, hit that like and subscribe button, and maybe consider supporting the channel on Patreon like these amazing people right here. You might also want to check out these other videos. On the top left, I have my most recent video. On the bottom left, I have a video that YouTube thinks you'll like, and on the right, I have a playlist to all of my quick machining tips videos. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.